good evening, and welcome to an exclusive ATX TV event conversation this evening. I'm Emily Gibson, and this is Caitlin McFarland, and we're the co-founders of ATX TV and couldn't be more excited to present another first for us. And I think a first for these amazing and impressive TV producers and writers.
I think it is a first for them too. Tonight's conversation is centered around Torchlighters, a group of women mentors and mentees that, until the pandemic, would have had dinner together to lend support and information in this fast-paced, confusing, and at times cutthroat world of the TV industry. Because these gatherings started over dinner, we thought we'd turn this into a virtual dinner. We've got some suggested course breaks for our viewers at home, starting with appetizers and then building to serve yourself a main course, and obviously ending with dessert to wrap up. So keep an eye out for graphics that alert you as we progress, and check out the notes on this show page for more information.
Before we get started, we wanted to bring out our friend Jessica Rhoades, an incredible television producer, and in many ways, someone who has also taken to mentoring us, something she may not have signed up for. She's going to give us a little background on how these regular dinners came to be and to bring out the rest of the panel. So you want to invite everyone else out?
Hi, gals. Yeah, absolutely. Hi. First, I'd like to bring out Marti Noxon, who is an Emmy-nominated writer, producer, and director behind such critically acclaimed projects such as Sharp Objects, Dietland, and the Peabody Award-winning first season of Unreal, and director, writer of the powerful film To the Bone. She is. Marti, do you want to introduce Janine?
I have the privilege of announcing Janine Neighbors, who I first worked with on Girlfriend's Guide to Divorce, and then she worked with me on Dietland. She's an accomplished playwright, and she is lighting the torches of others now, doing three different shows. She's doing Hive for Amazon, Quills for Hulu, and a Prentice Penny project for HBO. So I'm going to make the joke about I hope she'll hire me someday, because I'd rather work for her than myself.
Next, Nichelle Trumbull-Spellman is joining us. She is the showrunner, executive producer of the Apple drama series Truth Be Told, which she just won an NAACP Image Award, Best Writing. And prior to that, she worked on The Good Wife, Justified, and Snowfall. She's also the author of the novels The Dying Ground and The Last King.
Hello.
Hi.
Nice to meet everyone. And I am introducing Sarah Costa, who I adore. She started out as an assistant to my husband and I, and now she's a meteor working on a million different projects. We're actually getting ready next week to take out one of her pilots, which is wonderful and exciting. And from the very first page, I was thrilled to see someone that we cared about and who has become a part of our family do so well. And so she's gone on to a project called the Untitled Kings Project with my former bosses, Robert and Michelle King, and another upcoming project at Showtime called Super Pumps from the creators of Billions. And she's awesome.
Hi, thank you for having me. Next, I'd love to introduce Tanya Saracho, who is a playwright and television writer who most recently served as creator, showrunner, and executive producer on Vita on Stars. Tanya recently signed an overall deal with UCP. As part of the deal, she's establishing a lab and incubator program aimed to nurture and empower intersectional Latinx voices. Hi, Tanya.
Thank you for having me. And Jennifer Gomez, who I'm introducing, or, you know, some of us came to the last live, maybe one of the last live dinners that we had. That was really special. Jennifer, it's so weird to think of you as a mentee because you're so dear to me and so essential to my life now. But we met because she had heard there was another queer Latina TV writer, and she hadn't met one. So we like met and we were, hi, you do exist. Yes, we do exist, you know, and it was like that kind of thing. And she was still doing script coordinating, and she offered to take a look at my pilot because I don't know final draft. And she like just became essential from then. And so I hired her as a script coordinator for Vida first season. Then, what was your first level with Vida? and then producer by the end of it. And it became, you know, essential. Right now she's developing this thing that we just needed to be out in the world called Infiltrators, based on this documentary about, well, it's going to be beautiful. She's also working on the Untitled Kings project. She was on Vida, she was on Sacred Lies, and I think she has other, like, two other things in development. I want her to hire me too, especially because I never learned Final Draft, so like I still need that help. But she's like a sister now, so like it's so strange, especially from when we were sitting there eating, you know, like when we came to be, yeah. Anyway, I'm not a good introducer, sorry.
It's hard.
But there's a lot of love with this introduction.
I have the pleasure of bringing, Erica was my guest at the last Torchlighters we did as well in LA. And I, from the moment I met Erica, we had the pleasure of working together on The Village. And I just, she had already worked on Queen Sugar and Shades of Blue and is, I think to discuss maybe later, you know, had come up in the, in one of the Disney writers programs. And I always think that's really, I think you had worked on Ugly Betty coming out of that program. But from the time I met her, kind of amusingly, she had written the darkest version of the show we were doing. We were doing this like light NBC, like heartwarming show. And her sample was like literally the 180, like darkness. I couldn't wait to see the prestigious, incredible things that she would continue to do. And she has gone on to work on The Good Lord Bird. And she's currently in the room on The Spook Who Sat by the Door. And one of the things that right while we were working together, I came to know about Erica, and I was really in awe when we were starting to think about who we wanted to spend evenings with, these Torchlighters evenings. Erica was one of the co-founders of the Black Women Who Brunch program, a network of Black women TV writers. And I read about it, I didn't even know we were working together. And in the when they were featured in The Hollywood Reporter, which was like their biggest photo shoot ever, it was this incredible, inspiring program that I said, you've been doing this on your own too. And so I was really excited to invite Erica on the last dinner.
We will let you guys just take it away. But we wanted to kind of leave you with the first question of sort of what is a Torchlighter? How did this get started? What is its sort of like core purpose? And just hear like how you all came to be and to exist, even if we aren't all in the same place.
I think Marti and I were sitting together at a one of those ballroom situations.
It's where you sit around rubber chicken situation, yeah.
And kind of ridiculous. I mean, so Natalie Portman gets up to give this great speech, this really kind of amazing speech. Well, she's listing all of these things that women can do for other women. And you know, a lot of them are hire more women in roles that normally aren't populated by women. I think she had some other ones in there. At one point she says, take a year off killing women on television.
I did not follow that advice.
And Marti and I are sitting, it's the two of us, gals from Westworld, and we're all like, Oh God. And then she says, light another woman's torch. And we kind of all perked up because that's an exciting concept. And the actual thing she said, I'll just read because I kind of love it, which is when you light someone else's torch with your own, you don't lose your fire. You just make more light and more heat. Light a woman's torch. The light will multiply and the heat will intensify for all of us. And we just kind of looked at each other and then we started talking. And to me, and it's funny because we will throw around the word mentee and mentor because not even as it applies to this group of people, but because that's how we've kind of looked at what you have to do to be helpful to someone, that it's this huge, not to say response, you know what I mean? But it's like an ongoing, but the idea that you could just say, hey, here's another incredible woman. that I want other people to know is incredible. And to just kind of continue to amplify and make relationships and acknowledge, that's kind of where it came from, right, Marti? It was just a little more casual.
Yeah, no, and I think that in some ways, all of us, women who have invited women here or invited women to previous dinners, mentor was an uncomfortable word and still is, you know, because these women are lights, already lights of their own. But the idea of, there are a couple things that happen in our business, which is that, you know, this is historical, but it seems like men always had private spaces. Men always had great gathering places, and they had rituals that, and women in many cases had to really make a conscious effort to make those spaces for ourselves, because so many of us are multitasking so many different things that we'd run from work to home. You know, in my case, like I still was doing so much like childcare and home management and relationship management, and I didn't go to like smoke cigars someplace, you know? So things that were being shared between professional men were not getting the same amplification for women, you know? And we weren't sharing our wages, we weren't talking about our deals, we weren't talking about our efforts to diversify our staffs or hire more female directors or hire more female crew members or people of color, like, or queer people, or like we would talk about that in line to get our coffee when we bumped into each other someplace, and then we just scatter again. So a lot of our intention was just, let's expose people to each other and start and try to jumpstart these conversations, which might be a little bit difficult, but have to happen.
Well, and on a certain level, and I'd love to, you know, one of the funny things about our business is you make an introduction and then someone says, oh, let's have lunch or let's have drinks. And then it gets pushed and pushed and pushed because we're busy and things happen. And now you don't know that person somehow. And so I think we also said, as busy women trying to hold up the world, trying to not let anything fall through the cracks, how do we create those connections and those relationships? And for us, having a dinner that was what's turned into like these beautiful sharing nights was also to say, now you know each other. Everyone on the street, now you know each other. And so, yes, great. If one day you have time to grab drinks, hurrah. But if you need something, Erica, and you think that Tanya might know the person, you guys now know each other. And like that's the connection, you know? And like you can actually use that because we've had these great evenings together connecting and we can continue to bring people. And so it was a bit of that too, I think, was for us. And so I'll say the evenings get really personal and intimate in this beautiful way. And I think the tough thing about this environment is that it is public, but I do think that's important. I do think it is really important to note how things have changed and how people maybe here have seen some of the changes. I think that there's a real difference between the way we're holding doors open than maybe were held open for previous. I'm seeing a lot of people nodding. I don't know, you know what I mean? Like it's and I think that actually is where for me the idea of you don't lose any of your light by lighting someone else's torch really spoke to me when I first heard it. Because that's the feeling that you have to get over somehow. And I don't know why it's in us, I'll admit it, but you have to get over it to get to the place where you're like, everyone wins. How do I make everyone win?
Yeah, I think it depends on when you came into the business, because I can remember distinctly coming in and there was room for one woman and one Black woman, never two, you know, God forbid three. And you knew that that was never stated publicly, but that was so much a part of what was happening when you were being interviewed. And I'd gone through the CBS New Writers Program. I think it was an age ago. Anyway, it was a really long time ago. I went through that program, and one of the things that I had to do was sit with my mentor at CBS while she had writer meetings. And then a second time, I sat there while she had agent meetings. And I'll never, ever forget this. The agencies came in to, you know, present their clients, talk about their different clients, and they had their big binders that they brought into the room. And I'm just sitting in the corner. They go through, oh, we have this guy, he does great action. We have this person, blah, 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 blah. We have this person. Then in the back, no lie, it was a tab that said minority writers. It was about that big. And I was like, why the fuck are they separated out? Excuse my French. But I was just like, how is that not a part of the whole binder? And, you know, I was a young writer. I had not been staffed yet, but it just seared my brain. And then it also, I remembered it simply because there were a couple of friends of mine who were in that section. But it was the afterthought section. It was separated out. It just sent a really insane message. There was a visual with this book, and then that's the book that the agency was relying on. So you know that they went through their entire list before they ever start talking about these people at the back. And that was just, I've never forgotten that. And that felt like something that has started to change a lot, but I was on, it was the fifth show that I was on, The Kings, where I was in the room with another Black woman for the first time.
I get it. That's why Jennifer and I were like, another one, you know? I wanna say something that I hadn't told you guys yet, but after we left that, Jennifer and I left that dinner, the first one we went to, we were like, we need this for us, for Latinas, you know? Mm-hmm. So cut to, we've started this group. It's been like almost 2 years. It's called the Untitled Latinx Project. It's the 18 most badass Latinas in television, I will say. Like, it's most of the Latina showrunners in Hollywood are in this group, because when we were sitting there sharing resources, or the promise, because it wasn't like, I mean, it was like a fun, but it was like the promise to share resources. Like, and I had not had a mentor, but I had a sister in Gloria Calderon Kellett that like would be like, well, what does this contract look good? Like that kind of thing. Like Marti was saying, like the kind of stuff that other people get to add, you know? And so I was like, well, we should be a, since we didn't have mentors, let's be each other's mentors and like form a group so that we have like the ULP. And we took our own picture. That was really like one of those, like, we're gonna hire a makeup artist and we're gonna look cute, and we're just gonna hire a Latina photographer and we're gonna take a picture just and put it on the webpage. I mean, just, but it was, but that's not the main thing we've done, guys. We've written a letter to Hollywood. Like, we've done a bunch of stuff. We did the Blacklist. We got to the Blacklist and did the Latinx TV pilot list. So like it felt very powerful, but this group sort of gave us permission, and we went away. We were like, we need this, you know, too, along with this. Cause it felt, you know, it felt like there were so many of us that had no one to lean on, you know, in that regard. So anyway, now we're in this ULP that was inspired by the dinner and by y'all.
I love hearing that so much, because I mean, I can relate in so many ways. When I started out, I didn't see anybody that looked like me to ask for advice. And I had different mentors along the way, but they were usually men and usually white men. And so they hadn't stood in the shoes that I was going through. And it can be really lonely and isolating when you're the only one in the room. And it's like, who wants that experience? There's a lot of people that feel like if you're the only one in the room, you're special, but I think that's a setup. Mm-hmm. Like, that mentality is a setup so that you're not pushing back or challenging, why am I the only one in the room? I mean, certainly if you look at the other side, you know, a lot of makeup room are mostly white men. They don't want to be the only one. So like, why would I want to be the only one? And so like, starting Black Women Who Brunch, it's similar to what you were saying, Tanya. It was really just, I needed to meet other women who look like me, who are going through the same experiences, who I could, you know, in a safe environment, vent or ask for advice, share salaries, who's your rep, you know, like just basic questions that I didn't know who to ask, you know, and it's just blossomed into something that I couldn't even imagine. Like, we started with 12 people. Now we have over 100 people, and they are all just like beasts, like selling and creating, and everyone is super impressive. And continue to inspire me. So it's just grown. And I just don't think we realized what our power, what our worth is. Collectively, you can do so much more. And that's really what I learned from the group.
You know what's amazing is I keep hearing it come up, and I don't think anyone would talk about it publicly even 5 years ago, maybe 4 years ago, is taking the stigma off money. And Marti's right, men talk about it. It's a really interesting thing. And somehow along the way, I remember I was actually at a kind of women's-y dinner. And I was feeling pretty good about myself. Like I was like, this is a power, like positive women thing. And someone in a very blunt way told me that my boss underpaid women. And I heard it and I was so embarrassed. I was so, like, she took this thing from me. Like she was telling me that I thought I would, like, I heard it in all the wrong ways, right? Like I just heard it and I was so embarrassed. And I think at that moment, I understand why people don't talk about money, right? Like there was so much an association with the fact that I had settled, like her implication. And it was legit because I thought I worked at it with people who hired lots of women, and her implication was that's because they take less money. And I couldn't get out of my head in that moment. I was so disarmed by it. And another woman who is still pivotal in my life, powerful agent, had heard it. And she changed my life by saying, well, then we have to make sure you make more next time. And she took this personal interest in making sure that I was tremendously valuable and then counseled me how to get that in my next deal, right? And I just remember that. And I honestly reeled over it for a long time. But then conversations, even with Marti, when we, like, Marti's one of the first women who straightforward on a project we shared was like, you take your time and get yours. There's not many people who do that, and we're more and more and more, and we have to be part of that. But do you know, like, how do we change that? Does anyone have, like, it is hard to get over, right?
It is hard. And you know, this, what's interesting is my husband is a writer also, and I got to see it firsthand because we were negotiating a project, and we're not a writing team. We're two separate writers, two separate people. And I was like, do they not know that this information is coming to the same house? How are they offering you more money when I'm going to see it? You know what I mean? And we have equivalent careers, and it was just really, really interesting. And to see the excuses that everybody came up with as to why it was different. And I was just like, that's unacceptable. But we have a thing that we do when we're working with writers and we're working with other people, is, well, we just do one pot. So when we're doing a project, we're like one pot, everybody divide it, and then we just go from there. So there's no hierarchy out of the gate. Everybody pulls their own weight, and it cuts through a lot of the nonsense. But that's always there around money, and money is uncomfortable. When Malcolm was asking someone how much they were making, I got stressed. I'm like, he's going to think you're a pimp in his pocket asking about his money. That's private. But he's just like, no, this is the information that we have to know. But it's still so hard for me to give that piece of information out.
I want to know, this is exactly what Torchlighters is for. Like, I want to talk to you more about that, because I think, you know, and I think some of our guests, you know, I'd love to hear Janine, like, I know that I was slow. I've always been like, I don't do money. You know, the agents duke that one out. You know what I mean? Like, I don't want to get into that conversation. I think it's only, you know, I'll let them figure that part out. You know, I've been slow to advocate. I think, you know, I learned more in the last couple of years about how important it is for the showrunner to actually be an advocate, you know, and make sure that people are talking to each other about what they're making. And, you know, it's just, it's, But that's not how I was raised, man. You know, in this business, there's so many things that I've had to unlearn that I'm still trying to unlearn. I guess, Janine, what I'd love to know from you is, like, what was your experience early on around this stuff? Did you have support from people? I know that you know, we had a wonderful creative, like, mind melding, and you have such an incredible ability to create networks of people. Like, Janine's one of those people who walks into a room and at the end of the night, like, she has everybody's information. She can tell you all the hot goss, and she can, like, hot goss, because I'm
oh my gosh.
down with the young folks. But she also will just have, like, everybody's number, and she'll be like, gotcha. But I just wonder what it was like for you in terms of, like, coming from a completely different world of the theater, you know, dealing with pay and then also just getting hired.
It's interesting because, you know, when I first started writing, there was this thing that would happen where I was often the only Black person in the room. And I did not experience, even though I was the only Black person in the room with Marti shows, it didn't feel like tokenism. It felt like tokenism on other shows. Definitely. And I can kind of explain that a little bit later. But there was this thing that happened where, when I first started, where I remember I got extended, I think twice my contract got extended, and one of the other staff writers who didn't get extended was this kind of made this, like, off, you know, this kind of, like, weird remark where she was like, to another writer, where she got extended because she's Black, and like, you know, Black people get paid through, like the lower ranking Black hires are always paid through a different source. So, like, the money was there for her. So that's why. And it's like, no, I got extended because I worked my butt off, you know. But there is this thing that I think happens when you're working your way up where white people do dismiss you and think that because you're Black, that's what the talent is. It's not, like, your actual talent. So that's, like, this thing that, and I've heard this from Latinx writers and Asian, I've heard this from just women. I've heard this from a lot of people. And so that has been the thing to kind of fight again. So that was like a really big thing with me initially. And then I think, and then just being in one particular room where I was, again, the highest ranking Black writer in this room, this very popular room for an HBO show. And I was a certain title, but the white showrunner who had worked with other white people who he had brought on from another show, he was like, I can't give you your title because this is what he said to my agent, because the other people who I've worked with who are white will be jealous. So I have to keep her at this level because, you know. And so I was like, look, so I basically fought for more money, but it's one of those things where, looking back, I don't know what the right decision should have been. I kind of replay it in my mind because it's not a conversation I had with him, which I wish I had. You know, he's such a huge showrunner and creator, so it's hard to, like, his
desk in terror if you tried to have that conversation.
right. So that, but now I know how to have that conversation. Yeah. Now I know how to fight for myself and fight for other, you know, the room that I'm in now that I'm running, it's an all Black room and there's a lot of Black women in it. And, you know, it's made by Black people for Black people. I'm not unapologetic about it. And, you know, and I'm like, and it's just like fighting for what they're worth and fighting for them to be on set to produce their episodes, because that's another thing that doesn't happen a lot. You know, with all these people who are advancing, they're not, you have people who are EPs that have never been on set before. And I just, one of the things I love about Marti is that she enforced that with all of us. Like, I have so much set experience. My first year, just my first, like, you know, I did 5 seasons of TV with you, but, you know, so it's like a lot of set experience from that. And it's so valuable because a lot of the big shot people that I've worked with, just, they hog everything. They don't want their writers on set. They don't want, you know, to extend their contracts. So that's like, that's another thing that I'm realizing that I want to fight for with my writers.
Well, that's an interesting, it's talking about a different type of lifting and supporting. And I think a lot of women here supervise, and Tanya, you have your incubator program. Like, I think the idea that that you can supervise and lift new voices, that you can use your power, your stability to protect emerging voices. And I think that's a different type of safety. Like, that's a different type of protection, right? That's to incubate that point of view to allow for room for an authentic voice. That's kind of a different, right? Like, I don't know if anyone can talk to that experience, because that's another way.
Yeah, I mean, I also had a Latinx room, and then the last season, all Latina room, and then all Latina directors, all like last season, all Hispanic editors. And it makes a difference. I know we talk about it daily because we're on a thread with all the other Vida writers, but it's like, you know, they've been in other rooms, and it's like, you don't have to code switch in the same way, you know. A lot of people were queer too in this Latinx room, so like so there's like the ambassadorship that you don't have to do. Like, I'm the ambassador for all BIPOC people, you know, or like that kind of thing. But I don't know if Jen, you want to talk about it, just the difference between the feeling of that, you know, the like is a different creative safety.
Yeah, I always tell people, like, I am forever broken, but broken in the best way possible, in terms of, like, I came up in a room that was all Latinx, you know, like, I was empowered in a way that I realized a lot of my writer friends who we've come up together from assistants to writers, like, a lot of them who worked in a lot of different rooms were, you know, they were sometimes the only person of color in the room. It's just a whole different experience, you know, and I think even in the Vila room, like, we saw it, some of the upper levels that came in with some traumas, you know, and like that was like something that I remember, Tanya, like let's work on this. It's a safe space.
Yeah.
It's okay to pitch, yeah. And, you know, it's okay to, you know, pull from this experience or that experience. So, I mean, yeah, for me, like, there's no going back. Like, I think that's why I'm pretty outspoken in a lot of the rooms, because I feel empowered in a way that maybe not everyone, unfortunately, has had that experience. And just to touch on the money thing for a second, I have totally benefited from it. Because of the Vida room, because we were very open, actually the only male writer in that room the first season openly talked to me about money. And I have to think, you're totally right, Marti. Most of the people that I talked to, upper level writers, who when I was coming up, you know, still coming up, right? But like, who I spoke to happened to be male writers who were willing to talk to me about money. Warren was another one, Tanya.
Yeah.
He like told me, this is when like the ATM gets like installed in your house. You know, this is when the Brinkstone trucks come to your, like, and I remember forever having that picture. And so I attribute now, like, that Deadline article that came out with all the WGA figures of like at title where people are. I know a lot of people saw those figures and potentially were a little bit distraught with, you know, whatever range you're in. But like, I have to say that, like, I was surprised that I was in a good range. And I look back and I'm like, oh yeah, that was that conversation that I had with Mando or with Warren, you know. And like, every time I have a deal, you guys, I like text these like Vida writers who are now my friends, basically, like the four or five of us. And I'm like, so this is what they're offering. Like, is it okay? And I also attribute it to my lawyer, who's like, I always tell her, I'm like, give me that white man money plus more.
Money.
But I feel like I may be part of the generation that's benefiting from like the fact that, you know, that people are, you know, opening up and that we're willing to have these like difficult conversations.
And, you know, I think that's the expression that I used when I was renegotiating, and I said, white boy money, that's the only way to put it.
Yeah.
And it's just like, okay, got it. And Malcolm, my husband, has been a real mentor to Sarah. And I think do you think that's helped you because you've been in male run rooms now that you've gone off on your own besides the Kings? Everyone else, it's been mostly men, right?
Yes, I'm about to have my first woman showrunner, and I'm really, really excited about it. But yeah, I've only had male showrunners. But I mean, I feel like I've been really lucky in the experience that you know, Nichelle and Malcolm have always been very candid with me, and it kind of demystified the process of asking for more money. Also, I remember the Google Doc coming out, and that was very eye-opening. I also think another thing that Jennifer touched on is just having, you know, reps and lawyers that are really, you know, behind you and fight for you, I think has made a world of difference. Because whenever I'm like, I don't know if I can ask for that much money, they're like, girl, you need that white man confidence. Like, get that white man confidence, ask for that money. And just having them as well as like mentors in my corner have been amazing.
This is totally an aside, but you reminded me, one of the things that I would really love to see in our future and in Hollywood is an agency that is run by women and not white people, whose leadership is from the top down. And actually during this recent, action between writers and agents, I actually tried to leverage a couple of very well-known agents out of their positions into a new agency. I really, you know, there was so much fear around that from the various people. It felt like this giant, and it is, it's a giant thing to try to establish a competitive agency in this climate. But I'm curious also about your experiences with agents, because I've had over the years, you know, I started writing now 25 years ago. I mean, I've had so many agents sort of deliver me back into the hands of abusers, for lack of a better word, or ignore claims, or, advise me against my own best interests because their other client was also on the show. Or I've just had, you know, it was interesting during this action where we had the Writers Guild tell everybody, we made a choice to fire our agents and really negotiate with them around how they were working with us. And it brought up such big feelings for people. People were so, I mean, I lost a friendship over it, you know, and it, I'm like, but I guess the reason I bring it up is because I think it's really important that our reps look like us, you know, that they have, that we, they share, you know, and if it wasn't for the fact that the agency I have has the person who has done for me the things that you're talking about, like been like my advocate and really helped change my career, I would have booked it a long time ago. So
I had such a hard time with agents. I mean, when I started out, I was really naive. I didn't know the right questions to ask. So I met at all the agencies and ended up at like a big place. And it was just like, I was in the elevator with Diddy and I was just like, oh, I'm going to be taken care of. This is where I belong. But I had a job. I was already staffed at the time. So when the show ended, that's when I realized I had a shitty agent. There was no strategy. There was no discussions of where to send my pilot or any of those things. I just thought it would be easy. I thought like, he knows how to do this. Like, I'll just take care of writing scripts and then he'll take care of getting me in front of the right people. And it was really just trial and error. And I suffered from that. I didn't work for 2 years after that. And it was like, I lost momentum. I didn't think I was going to get back in the business. And so when I did get back in the business, it was really figuring out, you know, the things that are important. I want an agent who looks like me. I want an agent who has the same sensibilities that I have. I learned that the hard way. I had a rep who was always trying to steer me towards like rom-com things. And that's just not my style. You've read my script, Jessica.
Like, I'm telling you, that's not her style.
It was like really trial and error, trying to figure out like, how am I going to get someone that sees me and sees the vision for myself and can help me, who's in this fight with me? And that was like a rough road. And so I always have conversations with people now trying to save them the missteps that I took. Mm-hmm. I always want to know if, you know, do you rep people that look like me? If I take a meeting and an agent tells me it's going to be easy to get you work, that's a red flag for me, because it's never easy to get someone who looks like me work, not the type of work that I'm looking for.
Exactly. So
right. There's, yes, you know, Nichelle. Yeah.
Yes, I do. I think the biggest thing is I had an agent that I left my agency because the agent that I was with, I turned down jobs because I came into this a little older. So there was a lot of shit that I didn't want to put up with. And I'd also started in this business working at William Morris. So I was one of the assistants always on the phone, hearing the calls, hearing how they talked, hearing how they talked about clients, how they traded one person's point for another deal that had nothing to do with them. So I saw all of that. So when I was able to sign with an agent, the first thing that I said is like, I worked at an agency for 3 years. So it cut to a lot of the bullshit. It just cut to the real part of the conversation, but it still didn't translate. And because I turned down, there were three different shows and I knew that the showrunners were abusive. And when I went to the first meeting, you know, they jokingly said, oh, everything here is on the table. We joke about everything. And that to me translated to, we're going to say racist shit. We're going to say sexist shit. We're going to make you uncomfortable and you're probably going to cry. And so I just thought, I don't think so. So I turned that job down and turned down two more. And then my manager called months later and said, hey, can you CC me on where you're submitting Nichelle? Because I got her a meeting on Justified, but we I don't want to double submit. And they said, oh, we didn't submit her this year. Now, if I didn't have a manager, I wouldn't have known. And I would have been out of the business and trying to figure out what to do next. So it translated me saying no to jobs that I knew weren't going to help me personally, emotionally, spiritually, financially, or in my career. Saying no to that translated to them as me not being serious, when the reality was I was very serious about what kind of environment I wanted to be in. So they didn't submit me for anything. But yet when I got Justified, they took all the credit on the phone call. I didn't stay with them too much longer after that, but it was a lesson to me to always have one other safety net. Because if I didn't have Diane there at that moment, I'm not sure what would have happened. Because, you know, like you said, you get off that hamster wheel and sometimes it's really hard to jump back on. But, and it's also, all my agents at the time were men. And it was also like that tone in your voice, apparently they can't hear when you're talking. So I had stated very clearly why I didn't want to work for these places. And, you know, they called me on a Sunday and it was a little bit of, you're too arrogant. And I'm like, I'm not arrogant one bit, but I know that if I get somewhere and I have to deal with what I suspect goes on in that room, I will quit. And then where will we be? So it was just kind of, you just have to keep your ears and eyes open to everything that's going on. And you can't rest on your laurels. You have to kind of check on people.
I'm so triggered by this conversation. I just love everything you just said. And I know for me, I've had the best experience with agents when I got really clear on what I wanted to do and where I wanted to go. So when I take my meetings now, it's, you know, this is my brand. This is the direction I want to go in. How can you help get me there? And, you know, it's very clear if they can, if they have real answers or if they don't. And they love it when you can fill in those blanks for them.
Yeah.
They, you know, when you tell them what you want to do, you're just taking the guesswork out of it. And then it's good to know how they're seeing you as well. And those are things that I did not do early on. I didn't know to do that.
Yeah, you just trusted everybody to do their job because you were doing yours.
How did you figure out how to do that, Erica? Like what?
The hard way. I mean, I had to fire some people. Which is hard to do. It's hard to fire a rep. It's hard to fire a rep when you don't have a job. There were things that I had to go through before it was clear to me, like, oh, okay, no, he didn't have my best interest. Oh, okay, we don't have the same sensibilities. They're steering me. A lot of times you think it's you. And so I had an agent early on who said like, oh, I've submitted you to those shows. They're reading you. It just so happened that I had a friend on the show and they said, we don't have your script. So it was, though, if I had never known that, I would have thought it was me. I would have thought, oh, it's my material. But really he was pushing for someone else to get on that show.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, I was too trusting at first. And, you know, it's just really seeing through the smoke and mirrors. I always take at least two meetings now. The first meeting with a rep is flattery. it's all, you know, we love you, you're the best, and I like the compliments. And then the second meeting is like business. Like, let's get down to strategy. What can you do? Where can you take, this is where I want to go. What are the steps to get me there? And if they don't have the steps, then we're wasting each other's time.
The question when I did the, I left that agency and then I went and met around town. And the question that tripped them all up was, how do you reposition your clients and what do you do when they go cold? Because everybody knows that everybody goes cold. And it's just like, you don't want to think that it's going to happen to you, but it does. And so what do you do? And Teresa Kang, who I signed with at WME, had the best answer and the best plan. And I took notes while she was talking, and that's who I ended up with. But it was like, everybody else was less like, well, you know, you're a great writer. You won't go cold. And I'm like, that's not true. That's not true at all. It happens to everybody. And sometimes you can see it coming and sometimes you don't, and you're caught off guard. And I want to be able to continue to pay my bills and live in my house and do the things that I want to do and have a career. So what's the plan? And it, with Teresa, it was like, even when you're working on a show, you're continuing to write samples, you're continuing to diversify. If you supervise, you know, a writer over here, you do this over there, that's keeping you active with other people. It's keeping you in everybody's mind, and it's showing the other things that you could do. And she actually had an answer, and none of the other ones did.
Teresa Kang was the agent at the thing I mentioned. Literally was like, lady,
yeah,
I see you. We're going to do better than that.
Yeah.
And TK has been to quite a few Torchlighter dinners. She also is not a friend, does not want to be on camera. So, but we are very blessed to have Teresa in our orbit.
She's amazing.
Yeah. She really gets it. But that is, I think, also what happens when people who hustle themselves to a place then turn around and say, I see you, I see what you can become, and you just need a little of my support. And that, I mean, TK is a beast.
She is, and she's not an agent anymore, but, and I have a new agent because she left, but I call her still. And I'm like, TK, what do I do here? And so, yeah, she's great.
I think so. I think everyone who gets to touch TK has a text chain.
She's great.
I wish I had this conversation 3 years ago or two and a half, I don't know how long it was, but when I had to fire my agent, Tanya came into my office and coached me. Gladys was one of our writers. I think I was coached by pretty much every writer on Vita on how to fire my agent, who just honestly, I was a number on the page. Like I was someone who, like, if I was at the time, especially the only project he took interest of was a thing that potentially had a packaging to it. Other than that, you know, I wasn't in his orbit as much. And I think there was probably a sensibility thing there. And so the best thing I did for my career, or one of the best things I did, was like, you know, move on and luckily find an agent that was super excited about me. And so I ended up at Verve, and I'm pretty sure Verve is in sort of like that higher, the bigger of the agencies, the middle bigger of the agencies. It's like, so I don't want to like say something inaccurate, but I'm pretty sure they're either 50-50 male, female, or even more female than male right now. And anyway, the way they work is in a team. Like I just get calls and emails from various agents all the time. I mean, it's made such a difference. But even just to have my point people, and I have two now in my team, but like my point people, especially in TV, who are like constantly calling me and are just excited. But I wouldn't have known to do that. Like I honestly would have stayed with that other agent probably because I thought it was me. And I thought I was like, oh, maybe I'm not communicating exactly. Like everything you're saying, Eric, I was like what I wanted to say or what I thought I was doing, but I thought I was doing it wrong. And it wasn't until I took that leap of faith that like all of a sudden things changed, you know?
Did you call and do the firing, or did you write an email, or how did you do it?
Did, and that was the next part of it, and that's why everyone coached me. But I did have a manager, and I was hoping that, you know, Jairo Alvarado, who I adore and like as really was the person who helped me in terms of like sort of, you know, launching my career. But Hayato is like the good cop in situations. Like he never likes to play the bad cop. So he was very much like, you know, going back and forth with agent and trying to, you know, field some calls. But for the most part, he really wanted me to be the person to do it. And I realized, I was like, as much as I didn't want to do it, that that is what I had to learn to do. Yeah. And obviously, you know, knock on some wood one day and I at y'all's level and I'm show running, I'm like, I'm going to have to learn to do that. Right. So it was one of the hardest conversations I've had. We left it, you know, pretty like open doors and both a lot of mutual respect for each other. But it was tough because I'm not someone who ever wants to let anyone down. Yeah. And I felt by cutting, you know, by cutting the string, I was kind of doing that.
There's something about once you have had to fire someone, I like getting to the other side of it and being like, that was exactly what this project or I needed. Like there's something about kind of, it's self-care.
Yeah, something I get real Sagittarius about it. Like I had been on a couple of shows. And this guy was like my dad's age. And he was charging me, it was a manager, but 15%. And he was like, you have a really great manager. Like that was like what the word was. And I was like, it takes weeks for him to call me back. And then I had a play at the Goodman and then he didn't come, he didn't call, nothing. But then I went to see my friend's play like a season later and he was right there. And I was like, I don't know why that did it. I was like, and so I was like, I'm sorry, agents. I know you don't want me to fire, but here I go. And it was so empowering to fire this. My dad disowned me in 2012. So maybe I was doing some kind of thing too. I was like, and it was like a lover's thing. He was like begging. And I get, like I said, real Sagittarius. I get like, begging is not going to work. You know? Like it was so empowering. I felt like this big. He's like a 63-year-old white man that I forgot one of those, I don't know, a fancy car. Like the one time that he took me to breakfast, you know, I saw him drive up in one of those low, you know, whatever, the one of those. You know, it just felt great. When I saw him in the lobby of the Goodman, I was like, we're done. The offense of this, how offended I am about this, you know, anyway.
Yeah. Oh my God. After I fired that agent a week later, we went to eat at BLD. If you guys remember that restaurant and the hostess set me right next to him. Oh, and yeah. I died. So I had felt so strong during the firing, even though I got the vapors afterwards. Oh, that was too much. And I sat down and I got the menu and I looked up and it was so awkward. It was horrible. Oh
my gosh. Maybe as awkward as the time I was sat next to my agent at a restaurant and Genji Kohan gave me a giant bag of porn for my birthday. That is
like porn DVDs.
Yeah, this is a way back, so it was porn DVDs.
I was like, you don't just go online. No, get it.
But dildo and the whole thing. She gave me this because I'm a little bit the prude, and she was just like, it's time to, you know, pop. Yeah.
He had the same first initial as my husband and I sent a text. I wasn't wearing my glasses and it said, if you want this shit to work, bring me some fucking ice cream, because we just joke text with each other like that. I sat there and my ice cream didn't come. And then I looked at the thing and it beeped and he was like, I don't think that you meant this for me. Like, I'm so sorry. I did it. And actually, it's not going to work, but that's a separate conversation next week. So it's not about the ice cream. Oh my God.
I will say that I learned after I got rid of the terrible agent, I had agents that were really good that could only get me so far. And I liked them very much as people, but we kind of reached a plateau. So I learned that it's my career and it's business. And I can like you personally, but that doesn't mean we need to work together professionally. But I stayed with them way longer than I should have because I liked them so much. And I didn't want to have that conversation. And it was me venting to a friend at dinner. And she was like, what are you doing? Like, you can't waste time. Like, we need to get going. And it doesn't have to be you know, it doesn't have to be the end forever, but this is just, you know, we've reached a point where you're not taking me where I want to go. And we had that conversation and it was really good. Like they left the door open. They understood, you know, as much as they could. And it wasn't contentious or anything. It felt like a very mature breakup.
That's good.
I think that's one of the things that's really like, I will say for me, I won't speak for everyone, but for me, it's a very feminine thing to spend so much intimate time with people, with our colleagues, with the people that are helping build our careers. And so it's hard not to take things personally. It's hard not to feel like you're gonna hurt a friendship when you make a business decision, when partnerships don't work out, even if it just kind of, I wonder if that's, do you think that's a more female or male thing? Or do you think that men have that too? Or they can just kind of, I have never heard anyone have this conversation about, you know, the line of show business, not show friends. For most women I know, it is deep show friends. It is really committed relationships.
Yeah, it turns into kind of almost a family situation for me sometimes. And that's what's hard. Like Sarah is family, you know, holidays, everything else. And so those are the kind of relationships that make my life feel good for me. So I don't know how not to have them, to put it frankly.
But I think cis white males, even gay cis white males have a certain experience in this town, in this country, in the world. I just spent the 5 months in that little island of the UK, and it was like, yeah, they colonized everything. I'm still like carrying those that cart, but like everybody else, brown men, queer brown men in this industry, like I think it's not so much the binary, it's more like the same people are, you know, the same type of humans are at the top of the tower, and there's just there's a lot of, it's not just like a ladder, there's a lot of us in different, you know, but sometimes it does have to do with femininity, but that doesn't necessarily mean they're female, you know, and brownness, you know, and how I would like blackness, otherness, you know, so I've seen it in lots of ways, but it's like this one standard that we have in everything, the standard like of beauty, the standard of everything comes from this one, like one set of eyes, in a way that it's like, so like we're still abiding by it, you know, like it in our stories we still have to fight it. No, she is gonna be likable or whatever, like whatever we're defending, you know, is that it's set of cis white males came up with it like 120 years ago and we're still abiding by it, you know. So like I think yes, femininity, but like any otherness, I feel like in this industry is not to like lessen ours. I've just seen like brown writers, brown male, cis male writers also don't have a lot of like agency in this industry. Sometimes it's in the same way, the way they get paid, what they have access to. It's just, it's time to like crack bones. Reset that shit and let it heal, you know, but it's like everyone has to be willing to do that. And that's not everyone, you know, not just the people at the bottom of the top, you know, the people
that's
at the top.
Good. That's what Dietland is essentially about. Jeanine and I worked on that show and it was basically just like, and we were advocating for cracking bones right about the time that Natalie Portman told us not to kill. Not to kill people. We were like, oh, geez, we're throwing people out of planes. I'm interested just because I tend to think that a lot of people who are going to watch this are wondering, you know, how did you get your first break? Like what, and I'd love to hear from the next gen, you know, how you guys got, how you broke in. I mean, we heard a little bit about like mentorship and how, opportunities were given to you because you were on staff, because you earned it, because you were there doing the work. But I'd love to know, you know, if anybody has had an unusual, you know, path in or what they were like. That was a really long-winded way of just asking that question.
I want to hear Sarah's, because we work together, but I don't know your story, Sarah.
Oh, I mean, I don't know if it's like extremely unique, but honestly, Nichelle and Malcolm were my path into the industry. I started as their assistant, like she mentioned, and they were really the ones that opened doors for me. I didn't know anyone in this industry, and you know, they became like family to me, honestly. And I learned so much from her and from Malcolm, just, you know, seeing her navigate this business that I knew a little bit about, but hadn't really experienced fully for myself. And she took a chance on me and you know, vouched for me and made those calls. And I ended up getting my first staffing job because they did that.
Yeah, we made the point, what we were doing is we always hire aspiring writers. So then that the relationship doesn't feel one way where we're just, can you get my laundry? Can you go take the dog to the vet? All of that stuff. So it's like, do this for us. And we know you don't want to be here forever. And show us that you're writing, give us a sample that you're proud of. And when it's time, we will do everything we can to help you get staffed, get another job, do whatever else. And so we've had 10 assistants and they're all doing really well. It's basically our retirement plan.
Also, we used to go on weekly lunches to BLD. Do you remember that? We used to go to weekly lunches to BLD in like every great restaurant in LA. And Michelle spoiled me and like turned me into a foodie because she would take me to all these amazing places and just let me pick her brain and like give me advice about the industry. And it's one of the things that really stuck out about, you know, working for them.
I think it's a two approach because I'm a super protective and Malcolm is just like, push the bird out of the nest and see what happens. So it's a combo.
Janine, how did you, I mean, I kind of know, but I'll pretend.
Yeah. So I was a playwright. I'm still a playwright, but I was living in New York and I was very, very broke. And I wanted to write a pilot. I had all these plays and a couple of them had been produced. One was at Steppenwolf and actually Tanya went to see it. That's how we met each other actually. And so I didn't have, I was in the process of writing a pilot, but I was also just hoping on a prayer that like my play would get me, you know, hired. And yeah. And Marti was someone who had like has a respect for the theater. I think you have your like your musical that you wrote about AA, didn't you?
So right now I'm working on a cabaret act called about older women called It's Funny Because It's Sad.
Anyway,
I have theater aspirations,
but you know. But it was funny because, you know, we had, you know, FaceTimed or something like that. And it was a show about Girlfriend's Guide to Divorce. I had never been married. This was like rich LA ladies, white women, you know, going through divorce. And I was like living in a 330 square foot apartment with a like maniacal cat in Brooklyn and, you know, working as a nanny. And so when I got the job, I was a nanny, but I also like was a chef for this family. So I was washing dishes when I found out that I got the job and I literally did not finish the dishes. I was like, and I just like, got on a plane to LA and I was gone, you know? So that was my story.
That's fantastic.
Erica, Was the ABC Disney writing program your way in?
Yes, I was working as an assistant on Lost. I actually think that job was what started my career. But so I was working for Kitsis and Horowitz on Lost, and they knew I wanted to be a writer. And it's kind of like Nichelle, like all of their assistants, they help you kind of move on. So ABC program is very political. I know that they had a hand in helping me get in. And I know Damon also had a hand in it. And so that was like, we'll help you launch and then it's up to you to fly. And so they helped me. I got into the program and, you know, have just continued to go on. And we had like a very full circle moment because I worked in one of their rooms last year in like a mini room. And so it was really fun to like shoot down their pitches and tell them what was all wrong with what they were doing. But oh, it was great. I love that that was important to them. And I know it was extremely helpful. It's definitely how I got going.
Quick question for Nichelle, and I guess for Erica, do you read all of your assistants?
Yes.
Because that's the right, like it's finding, it's going, okay, there's a voice here and there's something that I'm even in this early stage, I see it and I'm going to help foster it.
Yeah. And we read them, and then, you know, there's a lot of just a lot of talking about what they want to do, the stories they want to write, where they want to go, you know, is it comedy, is it drama? And then if a few people that we've had who have been comedy people, I don't have any influence in that arena at all. So I try to find someone for them so that they could, you know, have the person that they could talk to. But yeah, we read, and then that's one way we get started. And there's only been one that didn't have any aspirations to be a writer, but she wanted to be a producer. And so we helped on that side. But yeah, they're all aspiring writers. And yeah, it's been,
I mean, it's sort of the unofficial mentorship program of Hollywood. There's really one of the only ways, like that's how I got started. I got an assistant job. I worked as an assistant for years and years for different people. And you know, I wouldn't have been able to get my foot in the door otherwise. So it's interesting though, there've been a few, one I'm thinking of in particular there's two that I've kind of been like, you know, like I can't actually help you because you're just not there, you know? And one of them went and got a job despite me, which I thought was awesome. You know, like, she was just like, oh yeah, I'll show you. So, you know, amazing. She, I was wrong. And then the other person I think just really resented the fact that I was like, I can't help you because the work isn't, you know, the work isn't there yet, you know, and we'll do everything we can. But it's a real, you know, it is the one of the only paths in. And then the question, you know, I wonder is how do people even get those jobs, you know, like now it seems like it's one of the hardest jobs to get. Although there's 7,000 TV shows, it should be easier.
I know. But there's so many of them that have stopped hiring lower levels, which I think is really problematic.
Agree.
Especially because the orders are for a season are so short that people aren't getting the experience. It's not the same as doing 2 years on Network 22, where you're going to set, you're doing this and this and this and that. If you did 6 episodes of one season and then you did, you know, 4 episodes in your second job, that's still not one season to me. So it's almost doing people a disservice because they're not getting that deep knowledge and the experience that they need. And as long as I'd worked in the business, I'd been on room heavy shows. So there was not a lot of going to set and going to post and things like that. So even with Truth Be Told, season 1, I was almost learning from scratch. So I just surrounded myself with people who had deep experience because I did not have a lot of it, even though I'd been working in TV for so long.
That's a really good point. And the other thing that I found difficult is because rooms are getting so much, they're giving you such a smaller budget. It's also really like the question of, I certainly got the message. Like it's not easy to, you know, to have, you know, one person who is, you know, who is a person of color in a room that is really isolating. But I am also trying to hit, you know, queerness and, mm-hmm. And, you know, whether we have diversity of ability and, you know, all these, you know, I'm trying to cast this room and I only have so many slots and they're like, well, you can have 4 people. And I'm like, well, how do I, you know, as a showrunner, I really want to represent diversity. I really want this room to have every, as much as possible, but you got 4 writers.
Yeah. And you're not going to have them by the time you're in production. So they're not going to get set experience anyway.
Oh God, you need to fight so hard for that now.
The uprising happened this summer. I guess that like guilt set in to some people. And I started getting a lot of phone calls about, and with the right terminology, sometimes said wrong, which is funny. Like this men would be like, BIPOC, what's the wrong, what is that? BPOC, support staff, do you have script coordinators? Because I have to make my room inclusive. So they're looking at the support staff, right? That's where, and it's not going to be in the writers. That's not how they were thinking, you know? And I was like giving up, like, I make my script coordinators writers. So I put it on Twitter. I was like, oh man, this is a problem. I should start something. And then Mike Royce saw on Twitter, we should. Okay, so we've started this thing with the Guild Foundation. It's called the Access Project. It's like a showrunner training program, but for support staff. 8 weeks, we got funding from Sony. We got funding from Universal. And it's going to launch in about 5 weeks. I don't know, Allison is going to help us with that. But we did it because it was like, so that, you know, people know. But it's also underrepresented, not just BIPOC people. It was really funny. Like, and I helped as much as I could, but I was like, I'm all of a sudden, I've had one little show. Why am I the, of all the, you know, I've never even done those positions. You know, I got here like from the theater, just like sort of landed in diversity hire land. That's what I was told the first hour of my first day as the TV writer. You do know you're the diversity hire, a coworker told me. And I was like, what's that? And he goes,
they usually do that.
Yeah. Oh, they have to let you know who you are.
Yeah.
And it just stayed with me the whole time. I was like, oh, I'm only meant to, I don't know, you know, anyway, but yeah, we're going to announce that soon. This Access Project, because it was annoying there in the focus, but also, oh, this is a need. Cause we don't have entry points, you know, people from underrepresenting, we don't have the uncles and the tiki-tiki, you know, to be like, you know, you're going to let me in.
Yeah.
I think we were going to hear Jen. Sorry.
Oh, I was just going to say, I'm so excited to do that with you. You know how I'm like nerdy I am about script coordinating because I had to do it for so many years. Because the problem is, yes, it's hard to get in, even to get that assistant position. So we need, you know, we need the kind of like the programs like that one that you're creating to like potentially get people in the door. But then the bridge to staff is also so hard. And I, you know, had multiple showrunners and did multiple shows. And I was always like, oh, we love you and you have such a great script. And I heard this like twice, but there's this, you know, person in line who's in front of you who's assisted us for 4 years. And both times it was like, he's been here for 4 years. You know, they've been here for 4 years. And so I felt like I was never next in line because I just hadn't made that connection. So I always, when I think about my career and how it started and like when I knew like, oh, I finally made it, it was like being on Vida. And like, we had this like, for like promoting like the first season, there was this double-decker bus that like Stars paid for us to go around town and basically WeHo through the gay bars to like promote the show. And I'm like, on the top is double-decker with all these queer women and mostly Latina women. And I was just like, this is it. Like I've made it because I've staffed on the show. And I'm back in WeHo, I lived in WeHo at the time, like literally at, you know, where I would normally go out, like promoting the show. There was something so special about that. So when I think about it, I always think like there is two careers I had. There was the career before Tanya, which was a script coordinated career that I did even despite my dyslexia, because like, I just fucking had to do it, even though it was brutal, but I nerded out on it because I had to try to like, you know, as I was coming up, you know, teach other people, especially we just always needed bilingual script coordinators. Everyone always needed it. So anytime I had a chance, like, you know, I try to give some advice. And then there's a career after Tanya, which is like, I always say like when Tanya came and met me, she was in her walker because she had just had back surgery and like a lot of complications and literally came to meet me just because she had heard that I was a queer Latina. And so she was finally the person that championed me. And I think that's the problem, but that's why these spaces, like the ones that you guys have created, like are so important because the bridge to sort of move up, whether it's from assistant to staff, from lower level to mid level to upper level to, I mean, from non, right, from staffing to creator, like all those are really hard bridges to like get across. Without champions. So I feel like, yeah, I mean, for me, like, I, yeah, without Tanya, I wouldn't be here basically. She always says no, and she hates me calling me her mentor because, like, she, you know, she says I had a career before her, which I did, but it was a career of being an assistant, you know, not the career I wanted.
I mean, there's a reason that these dinners tend to go on for hours and hours and hours, and we like stumble out feeling so good and warm, because even though it's hard, it is actually hard stuff. It feels so much better when we do it together and when we acknowledge each other. And I think that's, there is just the concept that giving a little of our light doesn't take anything away, and it actually makes it warmer and brighter for everyone. I love it that we get to do it in this industry, but I also think it's something we can do everywhere in the world. It literally is that strange thing that it's just a little bit of warmth can kind of lift up all the women that we come in contact with. So I'm so grateful for you ladies joining us and taking this out of the backyard and out of the restaurant and sharing it with a few people who hopefully themselves will find a way to light another woman's torch maybe tomorrow. Thank you so much.
Thank you guys. Thanks everybody. That was so much.
Thank you. Thank you. That was wonderful. Awesome.